Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. In your great compassion, blot out my offenses.
Wash me through and through from my wickedness, and cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my offenses, and my sin is ever before me.
Against you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are justified when you speak and write in your judgment.
Indeed, I was born steeped in wickedness, a sinner from my mother's womb.
Indeed, you delight in truth deep within me, and would have me know wisdom deep
Remove my sins with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be purer than snow.
Let me hear joy and gladness, that the body you have broken may rejoice.
Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my wickedness.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain me with your bountiful Spirit.
Let me teach your ways to offenders, and sinners shall be restored to you.
Rescue me from bloodshed, O God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing of your righteousness.
O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall proclaim your praise.
For you take no delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You are not pleased with burnt offering.
The sacrifice of God is a troubled spirit. A troubled and broken heart, O God, you will not despise.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, you hate nothing you have made, and you forgive the sins of all who are penitent. Create in us new and honest hearts, so that, truly repenting of our sins, we may receive from you, the God of all mercy, full pardon and forgiveness through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from Joel. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming, it is near, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness. Like blackness spread upon the mountains, a great and powerful army comes, there like has never been from of old, nor will be again after them in the ages to come. Yet even now, says the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning. Rend your hearts and not your clothing. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and relents from punishing. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God? Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the aged, gather the children, even infants at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her canopy. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not make your heritage a mockery, a byword among the nations. Why should it be said among the people, where is their God? The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A reading from 2 Corinthians. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way, though great through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and in dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. We are treated as impostors, and yet are true, as unknown and yet are well known, as dying and see we are alive, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing everything. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 6th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them, for then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father, who sees in secret, will reward you. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door, and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you fast, do not look dismal like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces so as to show others that they are fasting. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that your fasting may be seen not by others, but by your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I would like you to think on a particular word in this time of Lent, in this lengthening of days. The word I would like you to think on is the word return. It is an important word, return is. It is an important word for us as Christians, and it resonates with us whether we are most regular in our attendance in church or whether we are Christians who, for whatever reason, worship only occasionally in church. It is an important word for every baptized Christian. We Christians are constantly processing forward, moving onward with the cross of Christ leading the way. We are a people of the present and a people of the future, always listening for God's will for us today and for tomorrow as we process ahead in this world. We are people of the future who are always looking ahead to the advent of our God when he will come again in glory. But we are also a people who are constantly returning. And that is a good thing, an important thing, a necessary thing. It is necessary for us to constantly return in order that we may be constant in our processing forward. That is, we are constantly returning to this place for worship, to worship our Lord. We are constantly returning to be nourished by the body and blood of Christ. We are constantly returning to fellowship and gathering with like people, brothers and sisters in Christ. We return to reflection. We return to ask forgiveness every day. We return to forgiving. We return, if we are open to it, and I pray we all are, to accepting that we are forgiven. We return to the Word of God, to reading the Scripture, to hearing it read and proclaimed. We constantly return. We return. This evening, our gospel acclamation sings out, "Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love." That is a direct quote from the 13th verse of our lesson from the book of the prophet Joel this evening. The Hebrew word is translated, the Hebrew word used in Joel is translated as return, literally means to turn around, to change one's direction. For the prophet who prophesies to the community, it means stop walking away from God, turn around and begin to walk toward God. I had a coworker once who expressed to me that they considered my faith tradition, Lutheranism, a cult and not at all Christian. Now, they'd have said that about Roman Catholics or Episcopalians and probably most other mainline denomination churches as well. They believed that because we do things that were not, in their pastor's eye, scriptural. We do cultish things like observe Lent. That's what they told me. I wish at the time I had known this reading from Joel well, that tells us to return to the Lord. I believe this scripture from the book of the prophet Joel, which tells us to return to the Lord. I think it is clear, even in the time of Joel, that it was important to be reminded that we need to return to the Lord in the very same way we do in Lent. In truth, my coworker, my friend, and their pastor, they knew very well that we are all sinners, and there's practically nothing that we can do in which there can be found no fault. That pastor did become a friend of mine, and in time, we came to find a mutual appreciation for each other's traditions, and yet still today I expect both would continue to challenge our attention to Lent. And most particularly, the thing that they found most cult-like about our Lenten tradition, and that thing, well, that practice of walking around with ashen crosses on our foreheads on a day in which we hear a reading from our scripture which tells us to beware of practicing our piety in front of others. And let me tell you, I get that. Most of you have heard me tell of my grade school antics on Ash Wednesday as the most zealous of Lutherans, asking my fellow classmates why they had dirt on their foreheads, licking my finger and pretending I was going to wash it off for them. And those of you who know me also know that at some point later on, this most zealous of Lutherans went away from the church, lost his religion, nearly lost my faith. Perhaps I had. But now here I am before you, wearing a black shirt with a white collar. I'm wearing office vestments, a cassock and surplice, and a purple stole. And of course, in other years, I would be wearing an ashen cross on my forehead, just like my grade school classmates. Is it cult-like? Does it elevate me to a place where I am above you? Certainly not. No. What does it mean? What does it mean for me to wear particular clothes? What does it mean for me to be called pastor? What does it mean for you to be called a Lutheran Christian or a Catholic Christian or a Methodist Christian or a Christian Christian? What does it mean? It means we are set aside because we have received the gift of faith in Jesus Christ. And today we do not practice our piety before others by wearing an ashen cross on our foreheads. We wear a sign that says who we are, that tells of whose we are. A sign of sin, a sign of being washed clean, a sign of death, a sign of new life. It's our great opportunity today. It happens only once a year. It's our opportunity to say to everyone, this is who I am, this is whose I am. You got a problem with that? Ask me. You want to know about this ashen cross? Please ask me. I want to tell you. But wait, Pastor. You got no ashen cross on your forehead. Neither do we today. Not this Ash Wednesday. Ah. Right. Well, then think about that. You see, every single day we walk around in this world with a cross that was placed upon our foreheads in our baptism. Every day leading the way. And while folks might very well think it odd if you stop them and ask them if you want to know what that cross that isn't there, that they can't see, is about, perhaps we might be well served to be as aware of that cross placed on our foreheads at baptism as we are the ashen one that we wear once a year. And perhaps the Church of Jesus Christ would also be better served. Indeed, imagine if we were so aware of the cross that has led us every single day of our baptismal life, of our baptismal journey, as we are of the one we normally wear on Ash Wednesday. If we were so aware of it that we could say to everyone we meet, let me tell you about this cross. Let me tell you about the joy and the life it brings. And that if we were so aware of it, that every day when we looked in the mirror, we'd say, each day I return to Christ. Each day I return to the Word of God. Each day as I clean my hair and I wash my face, each day as I wake, I return to the Lord my God. Each day I return to the reality that while I am imperfect, God, who is perfect and just, has claimed me as his very child. In this lengthening of days, I pray you think on a very particular word. Return. Turn around. Each day, turn around. Each day in this Lenten tide, turn away from any earthly thing that draws you away from Christ and return. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and relents from punishing. Carry that cross placed on your forehead in your baptism wherever you go. Know that it's leading your way by the living of your lives. Dedicate this lengthening of days, this journey to the cross, as a time to return to that truth and to share that truth with all you meet. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends in Christ, today with the whole church we enter the time of remembering Jesus' Passover from death to life, and our life in Christ is renewed. We begin this holy season by acknowledging our need for repentance and for God's mercy. We are created to experience joy in communion with God, to love one another, and to live in harmony with creation. But our sinful rebellion separates us from God, our neighbors, and creation, so that we do not enjoy the life our Creator intended. As disciples of Jesus, we are called to a discipline that contends against evil and the discipline of against evil and resists whatever leads us away from love of God and neighbor. I invite you, therefore, to the discipline of Lent, self-examination and repentance, prayer and fasting, sacrificial giving and works of love, strengthened by the gifts of word and sacrament. Let us continue our journey through these 40 days to the great 3 days of Jesus' death and resurrection. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God. The responses are, have mercy on us, O God. Most holy and merciful God, we confess to you and to one another and before the whole company of heaven that we have sinned by our fault, by our own fault, by our own most grievous fault, in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not forgiven others as we have been forgiven. Have mercy on us, O God. We have shut our ears to your call to service as Christ served us. We have not been true to the mind of Christ. We have grieved your Holy Spirit. Have mercy on us, O God. Our past unfaithfulness, the pride, envy, hypocrisy, and apathy that have infected our lives, we confess to you. Have mercy on us, O God. Our self-indulgent appetites and ways and our exploitation of other people, we confess to you. Have mercy on us, O God. Our negligence in prayer and worship and our failure to share the faith that is in us, we confess to you. Have mercy on us, O God. Our neglect of human need and suffering and our indifference to injustice and cruelty, we confess to you. Have mercy on us, O God. Our false judgments, our uncharitable thoughts toward our neighbors, and our prejudice and contempt toward those who differ from us, we confess to you. Have mercy on us, O God. Our waste and pollution of your creation and our lack of concern for those who come after us, we confess to you. Have mercy on us, O God. Restore us, O God, and let your anger depart from us. Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Accomplish in us, O God, the work of your salvation, that we may show forth your glory in the world. By the cross and passion of your Son, our Savior, bring us with all your saints to the joy of his resurrection. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. Merciful God, accompany our journey through these 40 days. Renew us in the gift of baptism, that we may provide for those who are poor, pray for those in need, fast from self-indulgence, and above all, that we may find our treasure in the life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. May God, who has called us forth from the dust of the earth and claimed us as children of light, strengthen you on your journey into life renewed. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you.
Go forth into the world to serve God with gladness. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God.